Good evening, everybody, and a very, very warm welcome to this annual memorial lecture that we hold in IGNU. It is like a kind of an annual pilgrimage of the mind, an intellectual journey, if you will, where those in IGNU make sure that we do not forget those who have gone before us and who have made the passage so meaningful and so constructive. The Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture that we hold every year is graced by people who come to talk to us about their vision of today and what they hope will be a better tomorrow. We are privileged to have listened to many, many speakers who have shared their ideas with us, and today it will be no exception. Before we begin this evening's program, I would like to request you all to observe a 2-minute silence for the huge tragedy that has befallen our country in Uttarakhand. Would you all please stand in your places? Thank you. The commencement of any program is made more rich by observing certain rituals, time-honored and traditional. One of them, of course, is the lighting of the lamp. I'd like to request our Honorable Vice Chancellor and our guests of honor to please light the lamp and mark the beginning of this evening's lecture. I'd like to request Mrs. Ram Reddy also to come up on the stage, please. The flickering of this little light in the darkness, defiantly braving the odds, symbolizing hope and courage, and in our present context, of course, the dispelling of ignorance through the spread of knowledge. The lighting of the lamp has always signified new beginnings, a hopeful future in all the religions, in all the cultures of the world. Thank you, sirs and madam. Madam, may I request you to stay on stage, please? Mrs. Ram Reddy, may I request you to stay on stage, please? We'd like to welcome you with a little something from IGNU. Vice Chancellor, sir, may I request you to welcome Mrs. Reddy with a potted plant. Our guest this evening, Professor Takwale, I'd like to request our Vice Chancellor to welcome him with a shawl and a potted plant. It's the wrong time of the year to actually be draping shawls around anyone, but I hope Professor Takwale will take it in the symbolic spirit in which it is meant and not to make him uncomfortably warm. And now I'd like to request the Vice Chancellor to welcome our guest of honor, Professor B.N. Kaul. Thank you, sir. And now Professor Vayu Nandan will welcome all the guests.
Hi, on behalf of the Vice Chancellor and members of the Board of Management, welcome our chief guest, Professor G. Ram Takwale, who is among us today to deliver the 18th Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture entitled Reconstructing Higher Education, Approaches to New Education for Social Transformation in the Globally Connected Society. Thank you, sir, for agreeing to be the chief guest of this function. We are honored by your presence, and I also welcome our guest of honor, Professor B.N. Kaul. Thank you, sir, for agreeing to be present in this function. I also welcome Srimati Premila Ram Reddy for having coming all the way from Hyderabad and for gracing this occasion. Madam, we are highly grateful to you. And I also welcome all the regional directors and their staff and the guests at the regional centers. And I also extend my welcome to all those who are watching this function through GD1, that is Gyan Darshan 1, and webcast, as well as those listening to this lecture through Gyanavani from across the country. And lastly, I welcome the distinguished guests, IGNO fraternity, and personnel from media who have assembled here. I take this opportunity to thank our beloved Vice Chancellor, who has nominated me as the chairman of this 18th Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture. Sir, I feel privileged and honored. I have been associated with this lecture since its inception in 1996, when Professor Gajaraj Dhanarajan delivered the first memorial lecture. I would like to inform all the members that it was Professor Ramji Takwale who has initiated this memorial lecture. Today we are honored to have Professor Ramji Takwale as our chief guest to deliver Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture. It is a very emotional moment for me to remember and recollect my association with Professor G. Ram Reddy as a student and as a student activist when Professor Ram Reddy was the Vice Chancellor of Usman University, and also as a lecturer of IGNO at IGNO when Professor Ram Reddy was the Vice Chancellor. He has left an indelible impression on my life. Once again, I thank the Vice Chancellor for giving this opportunity.
I'd just like to inform everyone that not only is this lecture being webcast, but it is also being streamed live to mobile phones. It can be accessed through the iPad, the iPhone, and all mobile phones which run on Android 4 and above through http://webcast.gov.in. So this is again another milestone for us that we are able to simultaneously reach out to so many people. May I now request the Vice Chancellor to deliver the presidential address.
We have the problem of size here, you know. We have to hide. Professor Ramji Takwale, Professor B.N. Cole, Mrs. Ram Reddy, distinguished guest, chairman and members of the organizing committee, media representatives, and my colleagues. Today we have assembled here, as you know, all of you know, for the Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture, which we do conduct every year in memory of our founder Vice Chancellor, who I think even the world has recognized that he was a renowned architect of distance education. And as I have said last time also, no hesitation, even internationally, I have seen it in the net also, and fully endorse that he was the father of open learning in India. There cannot be more meaningful occasion for me having Professor Ramji Takwale on one side as the chief guest to deliver the memorial lecture, and Professor B.N. Cole, who accompanied Professor Reddy to Delhi to establish IGNO, on the other side as a guest of honor. It's really a sort of an emotional moment for a person like me. It was, as Professor Vainandan mentioned, it was during Professor Ram Takwale's Vice Chancellorship that we introduced this memorial lecture series on 2nd July 1996, and it was Professor Dhanarajan, the then President of the Commonwealth of Learning, who delivered the first memorial lecture on face-to-face with distance education. It started there and it continues till today. I'm also thankful to Mrs. Ram Reddy. She has been encouraging us by her presence and each of these memorial lectures without fail. I mean, we cannot think of having this memorial lecture, believe me, without her kind presence here. We are grateful to you. Professor G. Ram Reddy, saying it deliberately for those of you who have joined Indira Gandhi National Open University recently, during last one decade, he served as a Vice Chancellor of the Usmania University in late 70s when I was serving with the National Institute of Rural Development, and he used to occasionally visit NIRD as a chief guest, and we used to look at him as a tall personality. And then he is the person who established the first state open university in India in 1982, which used to be called at that time Andhra Pradesh Open University, and then became the first Vice Chancellor, Founder Vice Chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Open University. IGNO, as most of you know, was inaugurated on 19th of November 1985, which we now celebrate as a Foundation Day. And the inaugural speech, I would like to quote a bit, delivered by the then Prime Minister of India, Shri Rajiv Gandhi. And I quote him, "Our endeavor is that in India, the poorest, the most backward children receive the best possible education. And in this direction today, we are here to take a step forward. This open university," meaning Indira Gandhi National Open University, "will extend educational opportunities to all the corners of the country." This is how this university was, you know, inaugurated by the Prime Minister of India. And this university then started with its first program, namely Diploma in Management and Diploma in Distance Education, in January 1987, with a total enrollment of 4,500 students. Within 2 to 3 years, in 1988, IGNO launched 6 more academic programs. This is for information of those who were not here at that time, viz. The Management Module 2nd, Certificate in Food and Nutrition, Diploma in Creative Writing, and Certificate in Rural Development and BA and BCom. These were the few other programs which were added, and the enrollment in 1989 touched 54,000. You can see from 4,500 to 54,000 in just few years. Professor Ram Reddy, in his report to the first convocation of the university, which was held in 1987, stated, and I quote, I think he defined what we are still struggling to define, "Distance and open education system appears to be the only approach which can meet the challenges of the educational problems in the third world." He did not talk of India alone. He talked of the entire third world. And he says, "It is a system which incorporates communication and education technology to their fullest and best. It is obviously the system to lead us into the brightness of the 21st century." See the vision of this great founder. At that time, he could foresee that it will lead us to the brightness of the 21st century. Then, interestingly, he quoted a poet, and we could see, those of us who are here, we could see that how these got manifested later on. People start saying, you know, "University at our doorsteps." And he quoted an Urdu poet in his first convocation, Vice Chancellor's Report Address, in 1989. I'm saying those few lines from the poetry. "Abhi miti nahi tarikhya zamane ki, अभी मिटी नहीं तारीख या जमाने की, नए चराग जलाओ कि रोशनी कम है." And it means in English, "Darkness of the ages has not yet gone. Let us light new lamps as the lights around is dim." Then he further quotes another one, again from the poetry, and fits very well into IGNO. Maybe the poet, whoever he had in mind, made it, coined it for IGNO. दूर से अलिम व नूर लाई है, दूर से अलिम व नूर लाई है, जामिया इज द उर्दू वर्ड फॉर यूनिवर्सिटी, जामिया खुद मकान तक आई है, ब्रिंगिंग द नॉलेज एंड लाइट फ्रॉम अ डिस्टेंस, द यूनिवर्सिटी इटसेल्फ हैज अराइव्ड एट योर डोरस्टेप्स। दिस इज व्हाट वी हैड अ लेटर स्लोगन, इग्नो इज द यूनिवर्सिटी एट योर डोरस्टेप्स। इट वॉज दिस फाउंडर वाइस चांसलर ऑफ Indira Gandhi National Open University, who could see it in 1989. I think we pay our greatest tribute to this founder vice chancellor. Professor Ramji Takwali, I have the privilege of working under him. From his schooling in a village near Pune, higher education in the Pune University, and PhD from Moscow State University, I think has traveled a long distance. He served Vice Chancellor of 3 universities. The University of Pune University from 1978 to 84, Yashwant Rao Chauhan Maharashtra Open University Nasik 1989 to 1995, and Indira Gandhi National Open University from 1995 to 1998. He was also the chairman of the National Assessment and Accreditation Council, NAAC. I was looking at Professor Takwali, not our personal experiences when he used to be the Vice Chancellor. Believe me, I mean, I have worked all his years when he was the Vice Chancellor here. And I still remember, I love to work under such Vice Chancellors who can stand up before anything for the sake of this university. I have inherited that thing from him. I still remember, sir, when I used to phone you in the evening, in spite of the fact we had on certain issues, we used to disagree with each other. Whenever I used to phone him in the evening, he says, have you taken the dinner? I said, no, you take the dinner, I'll take the dinner, I'll call you back, and then we used to talk for half an hour. I still remember those days. His lifelong concerns are to extend education now to help people, particularly in the scenario of diversity, disparity, deprivation, and large numbers. I could see his latest interests, very, very interesting. He called up eye consent programs based on public-private community partnership, large-scale direct training of teachers of school and educational transformation. He calls it very interestingly, which suits the today's environment, e-BEd and e-teacher training. And this is what we are looking for. Quality school education for all. He calls them virtual school and learning homes. Future now model with new education based on empowering and transforming processes based on equality and justice. And then he talks of OER, open resource for schools with new education system development on the basis of the Mahatma Gandhi's Nayi Talim. I think these are the things which are keeping him very busy, and he is the person we were looking forward that he will share his wisdom with us today. Professor B.N. Cole, those of you who don't know, the first director of the distance education division at IGNO, when that distance education division was established here, he was responsible for setting the ODL standards, worked shoulder to shoulder with Professor Ram Reddy, and moved out when he was Pro Vice Chancellor in March 1996. Because he has to take up the assignment as a director of the Distance Education, University of West Indies, also served as head of the Distance Education, Open Learning, Tertiary Education Commission in the Mauritius, and was also the executive director of the Staff Training and Research Institute of Distance Education, which we call as STRIDE at IGNO. I remember when I joined this university, he was there as the director of distance education division, and I used to sit before him, please teach me what is this which is called distance education. And he used to do it very patiently. He is still a person who is very meticulous about the commas and full stops, a rare combination in him, the language and the knowledge about distance education. I was very happy he could make it, although his personal circumstances does not allow him to be here because his wife is seriously ill, but he was kind enough to spare these few hours to be with us this afternoon. This is what we have today for this great memorial lecture. Coming back to IGNO, I took over as Vice Chancellor, as you know, 20th of March, sir. Immediately after taking over, I discovered immediately that there are two main challenges ahead of me which need to be addressed without any loss of time. Immediately, the moment I submitted my joining report. One, holding up 26th convocation of IGNO on 12th of April, where President, Honorable President has given his consent to be the chief guest. And you know, when the President comes, you know, your room is surrounded by big dogs, you know, searching, and everything has to be meticulously planned. Second, challenge was that printing and dispatch of the material to the students of the July 2012 session. We had not reached them with the materials. Believe me, from the moment I joined, I forget about being a Vice Chancellor. It was a war we started, and you had to fight this war. Nothing, not even half an hour, you know, rest. To 26th, I'm very happy, 26th convocation of IGNO was to be held after 2 years. And it was great that Honorable President of India was our chief guest. All the necessary arrangements were made by my colleagues, and the entire function was conducted in all property and with precision of time, sir. We were given minutes and seconds for everything, and we could finish it 2 minutes ahead of the time given to us. It was a challenge, and we fulfilled that challenge, and we awarded degrees and diplomas and certificates to 1,58,383 learners of IGNO, both at headquarters and at the regional centers. As far as the material printing and distribution was concerned, we worked out the estimate and found that we need 21,23,327 sets to be printed and dispatched. It was a huge task. I don't want to say the difficulties, what we faced, whether it was paper, printer, or everything. Not many of my colleagues, except those who were involved with me directly in this, know that this is the type of thing we are involved. I found it that this is our commitment, and we have to fulfill it. Sir, constituted a task force of my colleagues, a monitoring cell at the VCO office. Today I can say with proud that all of them, 100% of this leftover July 2012 material has been dispatched to the students, although it should have gone to them much earlier. The June 2013 term and examination started on 1st June, sir. As per the schedule, there were 4,54,000 students appearing in this examination. And we had to conduct this examination across the country at 782 examination centers, including 57 jail centers and 41 international centers where this examination was conducted. It also involved printing up 20,54,515 answer scripts. And this exam was spread over 2,131 courses. I'm very happy to again report, sir, that this whole examination process was conducted very smoothly without any major problem. We prepared a strategy paper, and I presented this strategy paper to all the regional directors through webcasting. The strategy adopted included formation of admission monitoring committees, regular weekly web conferencing with the regional directors, promotion of regional advertisements and adoption of DAVP rates at any cost, and few other essential elements which I thought, I believed, these are necessary for us. One, reaching out to the secondary and senior secondary schools across the country by every regional director, reaching out through the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan regional centers, reaching out through NGO network, reaching out through NIOS network, and taping the corporate organizations. So just now I have seen that our regional directors, I'm grateful to Regional Services Division and the director and all the regional directors who openly supported me in fulfilling this mandate And we are now receiving very encouraging results of admission from across the country. I think apart from this, we had, during this short period of around 3 months, very extensive meetings with all the 21 schools. We have discussed existing activities. We have charted out future course of action. We have advertised all the vacant positions, academic positions. We have prepared all those which are necessary, whether it is a finance report or it is the plan report for the next 5 years. We are also now consolidating our position in respect of all the MOUs, all the community college, all the convergence schemes, so as to implement all those decisions which have been taken by the Board of Management in its recent meeting. I can say that for these last, it's not a sort of a progress report, but for last 3 months, we have taken this work on a war footing with the cooperation of the entire IGNO family. I am receiving cooperation from each one of them. And I hope that it would lead us to streamlining of the system in the coming days. And we hope to come to the expectations which people attach with IGNO. That's very important, sir. I consider that we are almost at a crossroads now. We have to reestablish our credentials. We have to reestablish the credentials of the ODL. In this ICT scenario, we have to prove to the world that through ICT interventions, through ODL interventions, we can be as effective as any other educational intervention. We have also to keep pace with the rest of the world. I'm very happy to inform you, sir, that the Government of India Ministry of External Affairs have taken a decision that an India-Africa virtual university will be established, and it will be established as a part of IGNO. And we will be operating in all the African countries through this virtual university. This is something which will serve as a feather to this university, and me and my colleagues will get completely engaged and involved in these new challenges. Again, I pay my humble tribute to our founder, Vice Chancellor. My sincere thanks to the chief guest. I don't want to stand between the chief guest and you people. The guest of honor, Mrs. Ram Reddy, for encouraging us by their presence. And my thanks also to the organizing committee for their hard work and making this memorial lecture a success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. We would now like to screen a short film titled Professor G. Ram Reddy, the Author of Change.
A man who always said the very soft word and meant the soft word.
He had a belief in working in partnership.
Personal care was taken of everybody, right from the very important visitor right down to the small man.
A person of absolute integrity.
He had his feet firmly on the ground. He had a good understanding of the ground realities.
He has a magic smile on his face, which makes the people melt, even those who are opposing him.
Professor G. Ram Reddy, the man who revolutionized higher education in India by pioneering the open and distance education. In 1982, he founded the first open university, the Andhra Pradesh Open University, which is now called the Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Open University. Then, in 1985, he became the founding Vice Chancellor of the Indira Gandhi National Open University, which was again the first and the only national open university in the country. Calling it the new temples of learning, in his book, Open Universities, The Ivory Towers Thrown Open, Professor G. Ram Reddy's open universities were the answer to India's educational needs.
My memories goes back to late 70s when I was working at the National Institute of Rural Development, Hyderabad, and Professor G. Ram Reddy was the Vice Chancellor, I think the 12th Vice Chancellor of the Usmania University. He used to visit NIRD very frequently as a chief guest. And I had a lot of interaction with him. And I considered him as a visionary for the entire higher education system in the country.
He's a great persuader. He can persuade anybody. The fact that Indira Gandhi National Open University, bill was passed in 6 months, established in equal amount, that much of time, speaks of his great persuasive capacities.
This, the open distance learning system, is what brings quality to the most marginalized. Quality education, it makes it possible. That's why this is important. And this is his reform, educational reform of this magnitude, of this quality, and this, the reaching out to all. If this is not reform, what is?
Quality of Professor Ram Reddy, of being an intellectual, a thinker, a writer, a professor, an administrator, and at the same time someone committed to social upliftment of the less privileged sections of society, is I think something that makes him out to be a unique administrator and a unique vice chancellor.
He believed in the power of education, as is evident in these words quoted from his book Higher Education in India, Conformity, Crisis and Innovation. And I quote, "No developmental measures or inputs initiated into the society by the state or any other agency will have their desired impact unless the people are beyond a threshold of readiness to participate in the process of development, and education is perhaps the force to take them beyond this threshold," unquote.
Professor Ram Reddy was not only a visionary, I think it will be correct to say he was the father of distance education in India. He said, and I quote, "Distance and open education system is the only approach which can meet the challenge of educational problems in the third world countries." So he did not talk only about India, but about all the third world countries.
He realized that democratization of higher education through open and distance learning and the is a key, because he realized that conventional systems of higher education has no longer held the key to the problems of higher education. You know, then we need to find the solutions to the problems of higher education in totally unexplored new areas of unconventional higher education. So that is, the in my opinion, the philosophical origin of the open university system. And he was not merely the organizer of that idea, but he was actually the inception of that idea happened in his mind.
Not only there is criticism, but the correspondence courses were becoming milch cows for running the conventional courses. And then the correspondence course system may not be geared to achieve the real purpose of the new paradigm, that is open learning, quite apart from the narrower concept of correspondence course. It is this new addition I would call a value-added contribution by converting or by looking at correspondence course in a full-fledged open learning distance education mode, mobilizing again technology.
Setting up the research centers because of the national character of the university was absolutely essential, and each regional center catered to the particular states in which they were set up, and they coordinated the work of the various study centers and various other activities of the university in that region. So it was a sort of a complementary functioning between the headquarters and the regional centers. That was a good model for delivering quality education.
While being well grounded about the issues of his times, he was also a forward-thinking and a futuristic man. Talking about the changes brought by liberalization, he said, "Higher education cannot remain aloof and be a silent spectator of these dramatic forces." No doubt, his work and influence continues to live on and inspire.
Even larger universities, in the mainstream of higher education in India, have begun to emulate the openness inherent in open university systems.
How to go out to get to everybody. Now my teachers, for example, over here in the country, the school teachers in the country, they're in lakhs and untrained, and they're in remote parts of the country. How do I get to them? How do I help them get in-service development? I have to use all these.
Professor Reddy was a very ambitious man. He has planned this university on a very big scale and made announcements on the basis of the hopes that he entertained with regard to the future of this university. But unfortunately, he has to leave in the middle. And therefore, I took over, and naturally, whatever ambitions that Professor Reddy had were a legacy that I inherited.
I still remember Professor Ram Reddy's initial speeches, in which he said, IGNU will like to create courses for workers, small scale, rather just people who are laundry, then other things, and those who sell, do small salesmen, businessmen, all these courses they would like to create.
I have, even to date, a very vivid memory of my first meeting with him. He was an outstanding leader. He was a political scientist, but a true practitioner of the art of political science. One of my memories was that he said, "Look, this is a new university, new system of education. What we need to do is to enlist the support of the leaders in educational planning and administration in this country."
When I came to IGNU, it was through an induction of Professor Ram Reddy. He was Vice Chancellor in 86 and I was Vice Chancellor, and we were both members of the Executive Committee of AIU, and we became friends. He invited me to be on the selection committee for selection registrars in the university.
Professor G. Ram Reddy's contribution to open and distance learning, not only open and distance learning, the education system in the country as a whole, is remarkable.
Maybe if you were to leave today, you would have also thought of bringing a bill on a right to higher education.
We decided that we'll meet up soon after he returns from England and continue the plans which we had of writing things together, so formulating some of the ideas and so on and so forth. But he never returned from England.
There's no doubt of the kind of contribution that he's given to it.
We have also to work on the directions which he has given. for open and distance education in India. We have also established a Professor G. Ram Reddy Memorial in the IGNO library, where there are hundreds of audio video cassettes and other materials.
We develop training courses, and see, in discussion was the first Vice Chancellor of the British Open University, Walter Perry. He was a guest through the British Council to the university, helping the first Vice Chancellor. He said in Britain there was no training done. And I used to be present. My stand was, the British are British. They get into a job, they do it with integrity. In our case, it will get diluted. It will take no time for things to become every person's business. You will open universities in every corner, every lane, and things will become difficult. So we have to build some sort. And that gave birth to the Diploma in Distance Education, which Mr. Vice Chancellor, you referred to as one of the first courses. And that two story is interesting. At that time, the only training course available was Melbourne, Australia. They had a course, and we contacted them, asked them whether they could give us. They asked for those 7-8 books, $1 million. So then we had to create those courses ourselves. And the incentive given to the staff, whosoever joined the university for the first time, if he or she took that course, was given an increment. I don't know what has happened to that course subsequently. It was developed further to a master's degree, which was taken by more than 19 countries all over the world. So this was the third challenge, as I said, and this is how we went through. And the crux of it was rules, regulations to be built on, ordinances, statutes, and rules and regulations. And to fix every course that you created, made it move through that, which gave it a label, seal of quality. And then services provided through trained personnel. That gave IGNU a name. Within 10 years, it was an institution to be reckoned with. I thought I sum up it like this. That is, I see this as the legacy of Professor Reddy. And as you say, you have challenges. Perhaps these 3 points might be helpful here and there. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, sir. I'd now like to invite our esteemed guest, Professor Takwale, to come and deliver today's memorial lecture.
Honorable Vice Chancellor of this university, Professor Aslam, Professor B.N. Kaul, Professor Vayunandan, Professor Saudari, all distinguished faculty members, colleagues, and friends. It is a really great pleasure for me to have this opportunity to deliver Professor Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture. In fact, his nature and character has already been described by other speakers and revealed in the film about him. I knew Professor Ram Reddy since 1978, when I had just become Vice Chancellor of Pune University, and he was the Osmania University Vice Chancellor. He had a special fascination for Pune city for some different reasons. During his school period, or might be after schools, he left Hyderabad and came to Pune, did some odd jobs, and went back again. He always remembered that type of the visit to Pune. After his master's and during his dissertation, he took the dissertation on public institutions in Satara district and worked for some time in Gokhale Institute of Economics and Politics. That sort of association, no doubt, created very good friendship amongst us. And friends, as you know, Professor Ram Reddy was a great scholar, great organizer, institution builder, and he has created and founded two open universities in this country. For me, he was a friend, philosopher, and guide. In fact, some of the problems which Professor Aslam informed are the problems still continuing. They were for the first vice chancellor, second vice chancellor, subsequent vice chancellors, particularly publishing books on time and delivering them. I think the dimensions of IGNU, printing and publications, has gone up so much that it is rather very difficult to manage it, and it takes a lot of energy and efforts to do it. Now, nearly 30 years have passed since this university was established, and one of the aspirations of Professor Ram Reddy was to take the education to unreached people, particularly workers, farmers, and common people. In fact, he had that idea initially, but Sir Walter Perry, the first Vice Chancellor of the UK Open University, advised him otherwise. And the simple reason was that Allama Iqbal Open University started quite early, but it could never get establishment and peer esteem as a university because of the adult and continuing education for the common people. And that's why he had to change his focus, start the courses, and And this has remained a problem. How to rather change from the class education to the mass education? And in fact, open university should go to the people on a mass scale. Now, the massive nature of all operations are creating many problems. Are there different ways of dealing with it? When Professor Ram Reddy was working here as a Vice Chancellor and was around, this digital revolution hadn't come. It was yet to come up, and it started mainly after the internet became public in 1995 or so. And you might be remembering that we are trying to acquire those internet skills and adopt it in different functions. Now, this whole problem This problem of numbers and huge dimensions needed some sort of different approach than the structuring which was done initially. If we are to go from the class university to the mass university, and the type of technologies which we are getting now can make it possible. So the whole issue which I wanted to take up for the topic was the reconstructing higher education approaches to the new education for social transformation in a globally connected society. I'll be concentrating on four main points. One is the global connectedness and the outcome of the global connectedness, education systems, formal and open, new education paradigm and transformation, and consortium approach to new education and development. Well, all of us know now that internet, networking, various access devices like mobile cell phones, and now tablet has come in, is changing scenario very rapidly. Global connectedness has been created, and now one can talk with anyone, anytime, anywhere. This A3 connectedness, anyone, anytime, anywhere, is creating a global community. And this sort of globalization could be used effectively. Now, there are a number of new processes that have come up because of the information communication revolution. The new processes that have been generated by technologies are the digitization, where the copying is so fast, practically free of cost. Then the virtualization, you can create a cyberspace in which you can construct a number of things. You can move to the cyberspace, have interactions, create groups, and that's how you can carry out a number of activities, learning activities and other activities virtually. There is a process, mass personalization. It is a massification. It can go to the millions and millions of people. Simultaneously, you can identify an individual in the masses who could be served appropriately. This sort of mass personalization and group customization is a process in which you can personalize education while making it mass-oriented. This is really some sort of a combination of two extreme properties which we were not knowing earlier. And there is also another technological creation, and that is self-organization and self-governance. People are coming together, identifying their interest, and communicating each other, and many are coming together just for the sake of issue. I think this is the type of other approach which is coming up. Now, India is also participating in this development in a big way, and about 100 crore people are connected by mobile cell phones. 10% of it are internet connected. And the mass connected people or A3 connected people have created completely new mechanisms and paradigms. For example, open resource movement started with MIT, started with the Wikipedia actually, YouTube, and so many resources have been created by the people and made open to the people. Social networking movement. Now, during the last 2-3 years, one is seeing the importance and empowerment of the social networking movement. People are coming together, demonstrating for a cause which concerns them all. And it is creating problem before the authorities. So this has become possible because of the connectedness and various social networking media. Now, transition at present is taking place through the internet-based communications, and communities of practices are getting created. But this is another way of looking at it, and therefore, learning and development could be people-oriented and activity-oriented. Another major feature of the communication revolution is that it is offering higher processing power to everybody. Look at the mobile. The power of mobile, the way in which it is increasing, I think it will start doing practically all the functions. I think that is the type of other power which we are giving in the hands of every person, which was not accessible 30 or 40 years back, even to big institutions. I think that is the empowerment which is happening because of the high processing power being given to everyone. Now, in such a scenario, if we are to consider the educational system, in what way we should go ahead? Cyberspace, no doubt, offers a space in which virtual structuring could be done. Groups and communities can meet together. People can take different avatars and move about in this space. In fact, the activities happening in this virtual space cannot be controlled by anybody except by the individual himself or herself. I think that is the type of situation which is getting created. We are creating a technology-based society or techno-society or techno-education, and education and development processes are getting linked into it. Education should be based, therefore, on the natural social processes and not on technology, because after a few years, a different technology is going to come up. I still remember our experience that for our warehouses, we had created a given the contract of creating some sort of a procedure for distribution. And by the time it was created, we trained people. Somebody said, now this technology is outdated. You have to use the recent technology. So that is the type of other scenario which are appearing. And therefore, any educational system conceived must be independent of technologies and possibly methodologies. However, technology is inevitable. Inevitable in the interactions, inevitable in the development, and inevitable in deployment and getting results. Can I get the water? Now, what are the other requirements? One thing is very clear. Cyberspace connects anybody from anywhere, anytime. And therefore, global connectedness is possible. One can carry out number of the learning processes in that space. So global and local systems have to be created. Secondly, there is a personalization. So education is essentially a personal process of learning. Even though we work in groups, interaction happens in the group, but learning is personal. Now, how these group dynamics or group interactivities could be used effectively to make personal learning very effective? And therefore, personalized education and the mass or social education should be involved in the whole process. Universal and basic nature of processes of learning and development should be considered. And another part is creation of education and development resources and social support processes are essential, and creation of social value and wealth should also be the goal of this education. It should not be simply learning, but creating something socially useful. Now, just now, if we briefly look at the two systems, one is the existing education system used in the traditional universities, and open and distance education. Traditional universities all have adopted British or Western education system. It is a teacher-centric, top-down hierarchy. It is donor-receiver model. Knowledgeable teacher teaches, learner receives. It created a professional educational institutions governed by state government laws or delegated powers. And the open and distance education introduced a lot of flexibility, number of innovations, But basically, the pattern of courses, the way of study, and the way of evaluation has remained more or less the same. I think that is the type of rather just observation. And in a way, rather, the type of problems which we are facing are also the problems of the major universities, except the fact that they are having face-to-face classroom operations quite strongly. Now, these systems, which are the industrial form of education, were criticized quite heavily. Sir Ken Robinson, a British educationist, criticized it as a linear, conformist, and class-creating system, and clearly says that it kills creativity because it does not give freedom and autonomy to a learner. Mahatma Gandhi had criticized it long back, saying that it is a self-seeking system and doesn't take into account the social knowledge or the social interest. And it has rather contradictory nature as compared to the Indian culture and civilization. That was his observation. In a way, existing system takes the fragmented view of a human being. Head is separate, then the hands, and heart is also separate, not mixed with the two. That sort of the academic, skill-oriented, and affective type of rather courses are not linked together in a human being, but they are rather somehow remaining separate and isolated. Nayi Talim, which was rather created by Mahatma Gandhi after 40 years of experimentation in Africa and India, and established its formal structure in 1937, was concentrating learning with the working in life and work situations. He had introduced two important and novel concepts. One concept was Samavaya. Samavaya was learning for development, creating something new, and learning from development. Whatever you have created, is it socially useful, socially productive? And if it is not so, why it is not so? So you learn from the inadequacies. And learning from this development gives you a lot of other information, but which is of a social nature. So book learning process and the social learning processes were both combined through the Samavaya process. And therefore it encouraged self-learning as well as social learning. Therefore self-development as well as social development, and these two are the two sides of the same coin. The second concept which was introduced in Nayi Talim was the wholesome work. Work has to be wholesome. It should not be the type of work one has to do in a factory. In a factory, you become a cog in the machine. You are given a specific role, the same operation, you have to do it again and again for 8 hours, whether you like it or dislike it. Well, that is for your earning bread. So that is the mechanization of human being. How one can avoid this mechanization? And therefore, in wholesome work, there is the integration of routine, rest, in the sense that head, heart, and hands. They can rest, some can be active, some can be resting. Have added progress to your activities, to your work, and pleasure. So routine, rest, progress, and pleasure form an integrated expression in a wholesome work. And therefore, wholesome work is not a one-sided view of the work, but the holistic view of the work. And this is the important contribution by the Nayi Talim in the whole thing. Work outcome of this Nayi Talim, or the performance, leads to socially useful and productive work, or the social value or social wealth creation. And this can also lead to a livelihood creation and some sort of a career formation. So Nayi Talim was introduced with great ambition, but Mahatma Gandhi had a problem. He never wanted to go for mass production, because he clearly criticized mass production because it removes jobs from many and creates disparity. Because Western model of education was a class-creating model. And that is one point. And therefore, he opposed the industrial mass production approach. And that's why he was practically considered as a reactionary, taking people to the agrarian society and not taking the country or people to the modernity and progress. And that's why this whole model was sidetracked. Now, let us consider the new education and new paradigm which could be obtained because of the A3 connected society and A3 connected people. Well, in new education, all the processes should be linked with society, social and economic development. And the processes should start with the issues today faced by students or the teachers or institutions. And our learning and development processes should work with the existing problems and try to find out solutions by adding knowledge or technology in it and finding out better solutions for the society. In a way, new education system should be result oriented, and the result should increase the quality of the product or the work and should be useful. I think that is the type of process, and it should be creative process. In earlier other, creativity comes only at the higher level when you go for the research type of function. Everywhere else it is rather streamlined, structured, channeled type of education. And therefore, creating future, one's own rather path of development is an important aspect. Now, when we are rather suggesting all this, what is the basis of this? Firstly, I must inform you that for last 12 or 14 years, we are working with e-education. Many are working with e-education. And therefore, experiences will be different. But with Maharashtra Knowledge Corporation Limited, we created a scenario and situation in which today, there are 1.8 million students per year which are taking a literacy course on a quite a large scale. Then there is also the Bachelor of E-Education program, which though worked on a small scale, created framework appropriate for the new framework for the education. And there is also another project which we are taking in rural areas, which we have called it Shikshan Pandari. It is a pilot project to create mass personalized education on a large scale as well as highly personalized scale. There are also other successful stories and successful methodologies. One is definitely globally successful mechanisms like Wikipedia, YouTube, promoting cooperative working and collaborative working and creating sources accessible to all. The two other movements are very important: open education resources and social networking movements. They are the revolutionizing the approach to the education. And the next part of it, after MIT's OCW's open courseware, is the MOOCs, Mass Online Open Courses, in which teacher is having a distributed classroom attended by nearly 150,000 students, somewhere less, somewhere more. But then that sort of classrooms are possible tomorrow, and it leads us to a mass higher education. This concept of a mass higher education was not known earlier, but now MOOCs are making it possible. Nayi Taleem was added, at least this conceptually, by J.P. Naik, approach of role-based learning. Now this role-based learning, which he describes as a system for the future development in education, is scenario situation-based constructivism. I think people must be aware of this situation-based learning approaches, and both rather somehow coincide. In both these situations or both these approaches, student has to work in a situation. In case of a teacher education, situation is a classroom or a school or a community around the school, and he has to take the assignments and activities in that situation, identify the problems and try to solve the problems by learning global knowledge and some sort of methodologies and technologies and solving those problems successfully. Successful solution will definitely raise the standard and quality of the classroom or the quality of the school, or even translate it something to the community. I think that is the type of approach, and therefore the work-centric approach of Brother Mahatma Gandhi is more appropriate for the A3 society, in which person can learn from anywhere, anytime, and can have access to all the resources, access to the distributed classroom also. Now, what should be the objectives of learning for such an education? One thing is, it should be human and society-centric development. Well, one is definitely achieve self-development and social development as a part of individual personality or part of a social relationship. The approach is definitely to play multiple roles in life. In fact, that we do regularly, right from the early morning to late in the evening. So play multiple roles. Find out your own role, which you can do with best talents and best intelligences, and then become a change maker. You can become a change maker here. And find out rather unique functions you are bestowed with. This links with the talents, this links with the multiple intelligences person might be having, and everyone is not intelligent in the same sense. They are having one or the other intelligences, and identification of the intelligences is definitely a function of education. And lastly, definitely creation of a career path by creating something of value, social value, and earning out of it. Long-term goal is no doubt to find out lifelong learning paths, lifelong developmental paths, and career paths. And ultimately, one has to rise in the cultural and creative development. I think this is the type of rather just approaches one can have it. And the process is learning by doing, and to build one's own capacity in terms of knowledge, skills, and technology use, capability in terms of situated assignments for solving situated problems, changing one's own attitude, changing our relationship with the groups, group behavior, and then co-creativity. Co-creativity is working in small groups, big groups, very big groups, and creating something together. I think these three aspects, capacity is rather considered usually through the Bloom's taxonomy aspect, thinking skills. Capability is the application of all this in practical situations, in life situation, in the institutions, and has been used in the industries extensively. You might be aware of the CMM models, capability maturation models, or ISO models, or Baldrige model for that matter. All these other models are giving you the capability maturation and capability development. Co-creativity is a concept introduced by Professor C.K. Prahlad in the network society. And tomorrow's services should be delivered not by each corporate body independently, but by looking at the needs and requirements of an individual and giving a package of information or package of services by many. Development of an individual in a holistic way is the focus of the co-creativity brought in by cooperating or cooperation of a number of individuals and groups. I think education is highly personalized and highly situationalized, and therefore this sort of other approach is very much essential. And tools for other presentation and evaluation, we found that e-portfolio, personal portfolio and group portfolio are the best resources or the best other tools, and they can be used effectively for this purpose. And slowly we can eliminate end examinations. Examination is a big problem in the existing structure, but in the Bachelor of E-Education program, we found out that we can definitely eliminate the final examination, and continuous working, continuous comprehensive evaluation and performance could be a basis for any development. So there could be other problems in the whole thing, but yes, at least the framework is of that type. Actually, new education is based on learning added to the working and use of technology, creating wholesome work. Now, another approach to the whole new education is forming communities. Networks, internet, access devices, particularly tablet PC, is revolutionizing everything. People are predicting that just like smartphone will be available for 2,500 rupees within a few years, the same way tablet will also be available within 3,000 to 4,000 rupees, and this can be educational tool. Mobile is a communication tool, tablet could be educational tool. However, tablet has to be designed in such a way that all the educational functions required for teaching, learning, evaluation, continuous other record keeping, and the interacting with the teachers and with the peers, I think has to be recorded appropriately, and corresponding systems have to be evolved. If one can do all these things, then definitely tablet will be a tool for the education, and that is a challenge before us. Secondly, activity-based learning in situations of life and work should be our approach, because A3 connectedness. And you can rather join your distributed classroom from any time, and definitely you can have a face-to-face interactions on some occasions, like in distance education. Global-local approach is very much essential, as pointed out. Global approach requiring for all the global knowledge and resources, local approach requiring for all the local developmental highly personalized approaches. And therefore, future scenario will be, at least we predict, that global-local approach and constructivist learning can give us a different type of methodologies. One point is that when we use MOOCs, what will happen? Because the leading universities of the world are giving various courses. And if leading universities are giving courses on various basic topics, which are already repeated by number of classrooms by various teachers, students will say, we are having a best lectures, best learning material, then why we should have your one here? So this might be the problem in the future. And therefore, the institutions having limited resources, limited expertise, will be facing a different type of problems. So it has a great subversive value. And therefore, this aspect has to be taken quite seriously. And constructivist learning is the solution out of this. In a way, in education, we should look at the constructivism more from the learning and development point of view, not simply learning alone. While learning and development are different, they are connected by causality. If learning is a process, development has to be outcome. But if development is a process, learning can be outcome. So that is the relationship between the two, and the two are distinct, related by cause and effect relationship. And in any activity or assignments or project students do, one can find out number of aspects of the total system linked with it. In the activity or assignment or project, personal and group learning is associated. Wholesome work could be created out of the work students are in group are performing, which can have a social value. Situated development can be effected. Learning and community, learning groups and community groups could be formed, having some sort of common interest. And learning and developmental system improvement can happen with every cycle, because the solution, obtaining right correct solution, is an iterative process. It goes through a number of the cycles, and therefore system also gets reformed in the whole thing. And this last and important point is, in this case, is that learner has all the freedom and ownership of choosing the situation, identifying the problems in it, prioritizing the problems which he should take the first, and by looking at its importance to his other target groups and solving them effectively. So therefore, he is entirely involved in it, and therefore motivation does not remain the same. He is very much involved in it. I think that sort of the approach could be taken up. And I might say that in our BEd program, one student was doing such sort of activities by going to a school. She tried to improve the school by using a single computer. She could meet the public policy makers in the local area, got more computers, and she became a practically role model of the girls there. It was a girls' school where the children are coming from, poor locality. But she became a role model, and she presented all that case study of development in an international conference. And before she got her BEd degree, she had published a paper in an international conference. I think this sort of things can happen because students are tackling life problems, situated problems, and therefore their approach, by taking into account the global knowledge, social knowledge, could be rather different in every case. So another point that one should study is that definitely it is not simply learning or not simply development. There is a value chain, and student has to go through this value chain. In fact, system has to go through the value chain. Society has to go through this value chain for progress and development. It is an education and training must lead to social development. Whatever the products and artifacts or services which we create should create monetary and non-monetary values or wealth, which will give this some sort of a career, and it should lead to some self and social transformation. So this value chain is very important, and education should be linked with transformation. I think that is the approach, and here is an integration of academic skill and professional education. Now, how did they establish such an institution? Actually, we did this experiment by rather starting with some ideas and bringing in people. Just now in that program, 6 to 8 institutions are involved. We formed an Indian Consortium for Educational Transformation. Funnily enough, this consortium does not have any legal existence. How can you have organization not having existence, legal existence at least? With all the people who are coming there, I'm president of that, I consent. But I carry my identity as a secretary of some sort of other organization which has legal existence. So I carry my identity in the group. So same way that every institution is coming. Now since we are offering a program, charging fees and giving services, it has to be a legal affair. So definitely we have said that, well, yes, two parties who become nodal agencies must sign an MOU. Other parties who are rather giving some sort of a courses and services in it must sign MOU amongst themselves and all come together only for that program and execute the program under the banner of I consent, and we rather follow certain practices of transparency, then accountability and so on. So that's how the loose confederation or consortium can work very well, and that is the type of rather organization is essential, because people do not like to rather have legal organizations, then who is the chairman, who is the rather president, who has this power, that power. I think that sort of the approaches might go. So one can think of networked organization of the future society. I think that is the type of rather approach we are taking. And here such a new education system should use the cyberspace infrastructure so it can be multiplied very easily and extended to anybody. It should create a central consortium of provider community, course teams, and the might be the support teams, all supporting the learning of a student. They can form a community, they can have the activities for their own development and development of a system. Local consortium of the schools and might be the local people who are the supporting or who are using, they can form a consortium and they can form a community. I think that is also another point. And partnership organizations. And partners, all these are the form of partnership. Those who are providers, those who are consumers, become a partner here. And this prosumer type of rather approach comes in here. And only one point is that here private, public and community partnership, when they come together, should be non-exploitative, transparent and accountable. I think that sort of other restriction have to be, and it needs a, some sort of a culture of working together and culture of development. Now this is the concept of meta university or meta school. There is a cloud up where the global and central resources could be kept on a platform. Well, platform could be like Coursera or Udacity or EDX or might be any other platform. So that platform could be there. Course teams can work from there. Course, we are the, in fact, the course team concept has been introduced by the open university system. And course delivery through the cyber infrastructure, through the distributed classroom, and open education resources for every course. I mean, that's, it can go anywhere. Local institutions like a study center, might be schools, might be colleges, might be universities, can come together and form local consortium. They can have similar distributed classroom for their own purposes, but they need not reinvent wheel. Take the knowledge from the center, use it, and center is also occupied by the people from the local people. They can play multiple roles. He can be partly here, partly there. So multiple roles so that everybody can play and work like that. So this is the way of doing it, and this is exactly what we are trying to develop in Shikshan Pandhari in the rural areas. Actually, the meta university concept or the param university concept, meta and param, I think, have the same meaning. One is the English word, another is the Indian word, but possibly param has a far larger meaning. It can have a vertical linkage. Faculty, which is offering, might be master's courses, research courses, degree courses, undergraduate courses. Simultaneously, the students are going and working in the practicing situations for situated development. So the situated developmental issues will come in, and therefore school for developmental learning should be introduced. And the school of developmental learning might have contribution from the education people, might be from the communication people, might be from the technology people, or various faculties which are interested or which are having this as a developmental area. This is a developmental area. I think that might be one thing. And this school, along with the stakeholders, can create a param school for the school education. Here, clearly the area of application is school education, improvement of school education. I think that is the area of application. That's how one can. This can be applied to any area of application and any area of development by going to the roots of it. There is a vertical integration. Vertical integration, that learning could be at various levels, application is localized. Now, application here is a horizontal integration in the sense that I look at it, the classroom learning. I might look at this technology to be added in the classes and might be having the support from other areas. Might be the economics of education and might be social science faculties could be involved. Depending on the nature of the problems faced by the people there, various knowledge inputs can come up, and this is a co-creation problem. I think that's how it can be tackled, and one can do it this way. So, consortium for meta universities. And this is a program-based model, as we said it. But then we are trying to have some sort of basic principles. One is definitely, when to the coming together and offering it from the center, content should be free. Services are charged. So give, just now I think we are doing the same thing. Within the fees we charge, definitely students are getting the content. But it is not happening outside. So this is one principle we would like to do it. MOOCs is also working on the same lines. Will also work on the same lines. Definitely content is free and services are charged. Then definitely the best expertise and experience should go centrally to everybody. And principle should be known globally, act locally. Use global knowledge for solving the local problems. Consortium is, well, I explained, consortium is not a legal entity. People carry their legality into the organization. And knowledge created has community and social ownership. It should not be any personal ownership. That should be another approach. And therefore, the social wealth and social development is to be shared with all. All operations and outsourcing should be transparent and accountable. This vertical integration and horizontal integration is happening. And we believe that this is creating a different approach altogether. And this is all the basis of Nayi Talim. Nayi Talim. We are taking the latest technologies, but having mass orientation and mass empowerment approach. We have started a pilot in the rural areas. Partnerships is already established with national and state level agencies. And we are having local engineering college because technology is involved here as a nodal agency. And just now five schools have been roped in. But we'll like to rather increase the number of schools. Actually, NKN has given a connectivity at the engineering college, which is in terms of GBPS. Processing power is very high. In fact, GBPS, even in cities, we don't get it. But they are getting it. And on the tablet, they can download anything or start interacting in different ways. GBPS broadband processing power has the advantage that you can communicate processes, games, processing, various other processes simultaneously doing, virtual laboratories and so on. They can be very well created. So it is helpful for the education purposes. Two programs we are working in this network scenario. One is school education and this is school teacher education. And goal is to rather create central resources free for all and create a replicable model for the Maharashtra and for whole country. I think this is the type of rather approach for the new education we are taking, and we are really obtained our strength and courage from Naidali. But there is a contradictory aspect that Mahatma Gandhi faced and will also face, and that is existing educational and developmental models are top down, whereas the educational model which is proposed here is a bottom up. This sort of a top down model of development or learning and bottom up model of developmental learning are contradictory to some extent. Can they be made cooperative without rather taking away the autonomy and freedom of the common man or learner or developer? I think that is the rather a part in it. And therefore, the first and second industrial revolution as defined by Jeremy Rifkin is having that contradiction. But if you consider the 21st century industrial development, people are saying that third industrial revolution is coming up. Third industrial revolution, the fossil fuel and oil will be very costly. People will not be able to afford. Secondly, green and clean atmosphere is very much essential. And therefore, non-polluting oil or non-polluting systems, energy systems, have to be used. Both these are leading to a situation in which renewable energy sources have to be used, and therefore this is leading to third industrial revolution. And third industrial revolution is again distributed type of energy resources and distributed type of production centers. And if this happens, the education model and the industrial models somehow go hand in hand, and there will not be contradiction left. I think that is the approach we feel will be possible, and then we are getting third way of development. Now, whole point is that educational frameworks and the developmental frameworks have to go hand in hand. One has to follow other. Either education is a subsystem of the society, then you follow the social practices. But we don't want to do it because we are idealistic people. We have some sort of a future goals for the whole society. Then who influences whom? Society influences the education, just now that appears to be happening. Or education influences the productive forces. So that is the whole point. And therefore, the problem has to be answered, who influences whom, and education has to come at the center stage of all the developmental process by linking education with socio-economic development. I think that is the only approach possible. J.P. Naik, when he analyzed why the education commissions, educational revolution failed, he has given this as one of the reasons, that there was no third model available. But now that third model is available, it might come in the form of third industrial revolution, or it might come up because of the educational processes having bottom-up approaches. Well, there are certain issues, basic issues in new education, but they are since ages. For example, self and social development. How much should I be selfish and how much should I be oriented toward the society? Balance between self and society. That's why the samavaya have a proper balance between self and social. I think that is one part of it. My presence, personal existence has social dependence. Everybody knows it. I am because we are. I think that is Ubuntu's type of philosophy, tribal philosophy. But that is the Indian philosophy too. And if that is the case, how much I should be and how much we should be? I think that is again the same. And therefore, my cultural and creativity has to exist socially for progress. And what is my learning path, what is my development path and career path. I think that is also the major issue here. Finally, I might say that new education is a form of Nayi Talim in 21st century connected society. It uses all the latest technologies which are mass-oriented, mass-empowering. Education is briefly stated, it is a yoga, sahayoga, udyoga. I think that is the type of rather just approach, and therefore it is more of a personal development, social or group development, and industry development. Lifelong learning is learning for life, learning from life, learning throughout life. That is Gandhi's way of saying it. I think that is the real meaning of Gandhi, which gets expressed here. Education with adherence to the values should be the basic for the future models, and this is possible only when it is a mass education with development-centric approaches. So that is the type of the presentation, and what I feel that this sort of approach might be able to give us different directions, different value system appropriate for the connected society. And possibly it might give answers to many of the problems which we have faced earlier and create a new situations and new approaches and mechanisms for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I think one of the things that we take away from this detailed representation of his vision for new education is how local it is, looking at issues in the local context but from a global perspective, which is what the new millennium is all about. I'd now like to request the Vice Chancellor to present mementos, a little token to remember us and this day by. Mrs. Ram Reddy, would you please come up on stage? To our guest speaker today, Professor Takwale. Takwale? And to our guest of honor, Professor Kaul. I'd now like to request our registrar, Professor Chaudhary, to say a few words of thanks.
Respected Professor Takwale, esteemed Professor B.N. Kaul, Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Aslam, Mrs. Ram Reddy, Professor Vayanandan, Member of Board of Management, Directors of Schools, Heads of Division, Center and Units, Faculty and Staff Members, Distinguished Guests, Ladies and Gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to extend a vote of thanks to the esteemed Professor Ram Takwale, the former Vice Chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Open University, for delivering 18th G. Ram Reddy Memorial Lecture. We are grateful to you, sir, for finding time to be with us on this very important day and sharing your vision on this subject of great importance in the present time. Thank you very much, sir, for coming and sharing this day with us. I take this opportunity to thank Professor B.N. Cole, the founder director of Division of Distance Education, now STRIDE, for his presence on this occasion. And I would like to share with you that I started my career in IGNO with Professor B.N. Cole as a lecturer. And with a few more my colleagues, and I learned the ABCD of ODL system from him only. And I'm personally, and my colleagues will join me, we are very, very grateful to Professor B.N. Cole. And I express my heartfelt gratitude to him for coming to us today and meeting the IGNO fraternity. Thank you very much, sir. Our heartfelt grateful thanks are to Mrs. Reddy, who is kind enough, as our Honorable Vice Chancellor has mentioned, coming to every year to IGNO on this auspicious day, who is kind enough to be with us today also. I express my heartfelt gratitude to Mrs. Reddy for coming together. Of course, my sincere thanks to the Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Aslam for his presidential address, who, like Professor Takwale and Professor Cole, has great interest in using ICT for education and training. And all of us know that he has authored a book very recently that was inaugurated last month by the Honorable HRM, Ministry of Human Resource Development. We are grateful to the member of the Board of Management who are present here for coming and obliging us on this occasion. Our thanks to the member of the press for covering the event. I would like to thank the director, staff, members of EMPC who has arranged this telecast, webcast, and video recording of this lecture, which can be used in future. I would like to acknowledge the contribution of the organizing committee chaired by Professor Vayunandan, and they have organized a wonderful program. One more addition that we are thankful to National Informatics Center for enabling first ever MobiCast by Indira Gandhi National Open University all over the country. This is a unique and new addition to our programs. And finally, my sincere thanks to each one of you. Thank you very much, and thank you to all. Thanks. All are invited for a cup of tea, please, outside this hall.